Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today on the program, Mario Ritter Jr. tells us about a worldwide rise in popularity of Turkish-made television shows. Later, Brian Lynn presents this week's science report. We close the show with the lesson of the day. But first,
Turkey has become a leading exporter of television shows in recent years. Millions of people are watching Turkish TV dramas, known as dizi. Many of the shows involve the nation's famous historical and cultural places. Experts say the success of the television dramas has created a billion-dollar industry that continues to expand. Between 2020 and 2023, demand for Turkish TV series increased by 184%. That number comes from Los Angeles-based research company Parrot Analytics. İzzet Pinto is chief of the Turkish media company Global Agency. We reach over 400 million viewers every night around the world, he said. Global Agency exports Turkish dramas to world markets. Pinto noted, "The soft power we create with Turkish dramas cannot be even compared to what could be done in politics." The Turkish drama Deli Yürek was the first to be exported. Turkey sent it to Kazakhstan in 2001. But it was the love story series called Gümüş that brought fame to Turkish dizis. The story is about a traditional woman who must adapt to life in the city. Gümüş grew hugely popular in the Middle East. In 2006, viewers in Europe's southeastern Balkans area enjoyed 1001 Nights, a series based on Middle Eastern folktales. The stories were set in modern-day Istanbul. Turkish TV also produced the show Magnificent Century, a popular historical drama based on the life of Ottoman Sultan Suleiman the Magnificent. Turkey was once an importer of Latin American TV dramas known as telenovelas. Now it is exporting TV shows to Latin American countries. In 2018, Venezuelan President Nicolas Maduro visited the set of the Turkish drama Resurrection Ertuğrul. Haley Yuganati founded a website for fans of Turkish TV series called Dizila. About 1.5 million people from the United States, Canada, Greece, India, and Pakistan visit her website monthly. Yuganati said the popularity of the dramas comes from their subjects. She said they are about family, friendship, and love, and usually involve rich people in Istanbul or historical stories. Yuganati said the shows offer something for everyone, and added, "I see reflections of my mom, myself, and my siblings in them." Pinto of Global Agency agrees that Turkish dramas are right for everybody. There is no nudity, no cursing or bad words. Not much hate, he said. So it becomes watchable for the family. As Turkey's industry grows, it is expanding the themes of its series. For example, the series Red Roses explores issues affecting a family that is culturally Western and a fictional Islamic brotherhood. During a recent period filming, actor Ozkan Deniz told the Associated Press that diversification is important for industry growth. He said, countries that were not able to transform into a different genre are now lagging behind in the export of series. He added, Turkey has now caught this momentum, but if it cannot diversify, if it cannot also tell different things, it will end somewhere. Resurrection Ertuğrul is an example of the growing success of Turkish series. Mehmet Bozdag is a producer and writer. He said the first show of the series had over 157 million views on the Urdu language YouTube channel of Turkish state broadcaster TRT. Another series, Foundation Osman, was broadcast in over 110 countries. I'm Mario Ritter Jr.
Scientists say they have found evidence that the smelly molecule hydrogen sulfide exists in the atmosphere of a Jupiter-like planet. Hydrogen sulfide is the chemical compound that gives rotten eggs their bad smell. The planet is called HD189733b. It is an exoplanet, a term used to describe planets that exist outside of our own solar system. It was discovered in 2005. Scientists had already identified similarities between HD189733b and Jupiter, the oldest and largest planet in our solar system. But the exoplanet was previously not thought to hold hydrogen sulfide. Astronomers who study this gas giant have said it is deep blue in color and that severe conditions exist in the atmosphere. It has winds that can blow up to 2 kilometers per second. The exoplanet is believed to reach temperatures up to 930 degrees Celsius on the side facing the star that it orbits. Scientists also say it rains glass, which can be blown by fierce winds. The weather on HD189733b is so extreme, the American Space Agency, NASA, once described the planet as a nightmare world. New observations by NASA's James Webb Space Telescope suggest that this is the first exoplanet where hydrogen sulfide has been identified. Scientists say the discovery has helped give them a better understanding of this stormy world. The finding was recently explained in a study appearing in the publication Nature. One of the leaders of the research was astrophysicist Guangwei Fu of Johns Hopkins University in Maryland. He told Reuters, "This is not a planet we humans want to visit, but a valuable target for furthering our understanding of planetary science." Fu said HD 189733b is known as a hot Jupiter planet. However, it orbits 170 times closer to its star than Jupiter does to the Sun. It completes one orbit every 2 days. Jupiter takes about 12 years to orbit the Sun. Fu noted that hot Jupiters are not found often. About less than one in 100 star systems have them, he said. Fu said he thinks the newly discovered stinky smell just adds another interesting element to what is already known about the planet. It is 64 light years from Earth, in the constellation Vulpecula. A light year is the distance light travels in a year, about 9.5 trillion kilometers. It is closer to Earth than many exoplanets. This makes it bright and easy for detailed studies, Fu said. He noted, for example, that hydrogen sulfide would have been much harder to find on planets that are further away. The Webb telescope, which became operational in 2022, is able to observe a wider range of radiation wavelengths than earlier telescopes. This permits more detailed examinations of exoplanet atmospheres. Our research finds that HD 189733b is more similar to Jupiter than previously known, said Arizona State University astrophysicist Lewis Welbanks. He was a member of the research team. "This planet is very much like Jupiter, but just hotter." Jupiter, too, has small amounts of hydrogen sulfide in its atmosphere. But the exoplanet is about 10% larger than Jupiter in diameter and mass. The Webb observations also confirmed earlier evidence showing the exoplanet has water and carbon dioxide in its atmosphere. "With these three molecules, we are able to count the amount of oxygen, carbon, and sulfur the planet has," Welbanks said. That information, he added, gives scientists a chance to learn more about how the planet may have formed. It should also provide data on whether it is different from planets in our solar system. Welbanks said the scientists are clearly not searching for life on such a hot, harsh planet. However, he noted that understanding its atmosphere permits them to understand how physics and chemistry behave under different environments and to begin to put together the recipe for forming planets. I'm Brian Lynn.
Brian Lynn joins me now to talk more about his science report. Hi, Brian. Thanks for being here.
Sure. Thank you for having me.
This week, your report was about the discovery of a smelly chemical compound on a planet outside our solar system. That substance, hydrogen sulfide, is also what gives rotten eggs their bad smell. Why don't we look at some of the vocabulary words that we heard in the report that may be new to some of our listeners? I'd like us to start with one I just mentioned, the term rotten.
Yes, that sounds like a good idea. A simple definition for rotten, which is an adjective, is suffering from decay. When I spoke about rotten eggs in the report, this meant eggs that had turned bad or gone rotten. And we know that when most foods go bad, they tend to start smelling. This word can also be used as a verb to rot. And it doesn't have to deal with food or something else rotting. The term rotten can also just mean very bad, and is sometimes used in English to describe a person or their behavior.
Okay, and what is another term you would like to discuss?
Okay, how about the word stinky, another adjective? We were just talking about bad smells from rotten things, and the term stinky means just that, having or producing an unpleasant smell. So a main synonym would, of course, be smelly.
Another word that might be interesting to discuss is nightmare, which is quite common in American English. And in your report, the term was actually used by NASA to describe this exoplanet, which experiences very extreme conditions.
Yes, that is correct. As was mentioned in the report, this particular exoplanet stays super hot, has extremely strong winds, and is even known to experience glass rain. So the word nightmare, a noun, certainly could describe this kind of activity. It means an extremely unpleasant event or experience, and this could relate to many different things. But nightmare also has another very specific meaning. It describes a dream someone has that is very upsetting or even frightening.
Okay, and let's look at one more term. Harsh, also an adjective.
Sure thing, yes, and the basic definition for this word, again, fits right in with the other ones we've discussed, because, again, it describes those extreme conditions on the exoplanet, severe and unpleasant. So, synonyms would include severe, hard, even cruel, especially when describing a person. Another use for this adjective is to describe something that is just too much. For example, a harsh light or sound that is difficult to be around.
Okay, thanks again for being here, Brian. And thank you so much for those explanations.
You're welcome. Thank you.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
And now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. My name is Andrew Smith, and I'm joined by Dr. Jill Robbins. Hi, Jill.
Hi, Andrew.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
In our previous lesson, we listened to Lesson 17 of Level 2 of the series. The story of Lesson 17 continues in Lesson 18.
In the story, Anna and Pete each have to take care of a baby for 1 week. But their babies are not real. Instead, they are bags of flour.
Anna's boss, Ms. Weaver, wants Anna and Pete to learn about single parents who take care of children by themselves. To do this, she tells Anna and Pete to keep their bags of flour with them at all times.
Today, we'll find out how well Anna and Pete took care of their flour babies. And like Lesson 17, Lesson 18 uses many reflexive pronouns, which we taught in our previous lesson of the day. Those are pronouns such as myself, yourself, itself, themselves, and so on.
But Lesson 18 teaches one more thing. It reminds us that when we use a preposition of place, such as the words next to, around, near to, or beside, we cannot use reflexive pronouns after them. Instead, we just use object pronouns.
For example, we simply say, next to me, next to you, next to him, next to them, and so on.
Now let's join Lesson 18 and see how well Pete and Anna took care of their flower babies.
Okay, Pete, let me see your research first. That's a heavy binder. And you and your baby look great.
Thanks, Miss Weaver. We feel great.
Anna?
Anna, you're next.
Anna, Anna, wake up.
I'm here, baby. I'm here. Here's your bottle.
Anna, you and your baby look awful. What happened?
Well, I took her everywhere. Everywhere. And I fed her every 3 hours. So I haven't slept since... What day is it?
It's Friday. What happened there?
Oh, that. I was making myself a salad and had a little accident with a knife.
I put my flower baby in front of me, and then I accidentally stabbed it. But I gave it first aid.
Is that a burn?
Yes. Yes, it is. While I was making myself dinner, I put baby next to me. I accidentally knocked her into the sink, so I put her in the microwave to dry. That's when she caught fire.
This doesn't sound too good for Anna or her flower baby. Listeners, do you think Anna is able to take care of a baby by herself? What do you think Ms. Weaver will say? And Jill, here's a question for you. When your children were babies, did you have to take care of them by yourself?
No, I had help from my husband and friends and in-laws. Just like language learning, it helps when you have a guide, a more experienced person to help you. My mother-in-law had 7 kids, so she had a lot of experience.
Well, I think that was probably helpful. It sure does help to have a guide. On the other hand, what do you think are some of the things language learners need to do, or perhaps sometimes need to do, by themselves?
Practice using new words, of course, but it's hard to do that by yourself. You need a conversation partner, unless you're just learning to read and write a language. And the thing that you would really need to do by yourself is to read in that language. I think reading is a great way to build your vocabulary.
I do too, and it's enjoyable. And you know, with the internet, there are lots of ways to teach yourself many different skills. I know, for example, that I've learned how to fix some things on my car by watching tutorials. That's spelled T-U-T-O-R-I-A-L-S, which are videos where someone teaches you how to do something.
It can be fun to teach yourself, but On the other hand, I think we need a personal connection. And sometimes there's no substitute for working with the teacher.
I agree. And that's a good expression to know. There's no substitute for. That means there is nothing that can be as good as what you had. Jill, do you think robots will ever be a substitute for human teachers?
I think they already are, in a way. Language learning apps and artificial intelligence or AI programs help people learn languages by themselves, but they are not yet substitutes for the real human connection of a person.
That's true. However, robots don't seem to get angry or impatient if we don't do our homework or don't listen carefully.
Well, we could program the robots to show emotions if we wanted them to be more like ourselves.
That's true, but we might have to be careful about that. It is interesting to think about. And Jill, you just used the reflexive pronoun ourselves, which reminds me that we should listen to the end of the story from Lesson 18. Anna has stabbed her bag of flour with a knife and has also burned it. Let's see what Ms. Weaver has to say.
Anna, you should be very proud of yourself.
Proud? She stabbed and burned her baby. And she only did one page of research. And it's covered in milk. Ugh.
Yes, Pete. But she followed instructions.
Hey! I did the...
Please, Pete. Anna, I think your baby has lost some weight. Is there something else you want to share?
Yes, I'd like to share these. I made them myself this morning.
You baked your baby? You should be ashamed of yourself.
I baked them at the end of the experiment, Pete. At that point, this was just a bag of flour.
It was always just a bag of flour.
Pete, will you listen to yourself? You sound crazy.
I sound crazy. This whole experiment was crazy. She was the one who carried around and fed it and what... That is good.
At the end, Ms. Weaver says Anna did a good job because she stayed with her baby at all times. But Pete left his baby alone. Even though his baby did not get hurt, he did not really take care of it.
The poor flower baby. But Anna still gives him a cookie at the end.
All's well that ends well, I guess. Listeners, are there things you have taught yourself? What kinds of things can you learn by yourself? Write to us and let us know.
You can send your email to learningenglish@voanews.com.
And we will reply by ourselves. Remember, you can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. Thanks for listening. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.